My name is Mike Lottie. I was born at Highland Park, which is actually completely surrounded by the city of Detroit. And my folks were, at the time, living there. And Highland Park ended up to be sort of a Finnish immigrant enclave right inside Detroit at the time. And I lived there for about a year until my folks moved up here. One was a farmer in Houghton Canal, and he was married and had several children. His wife, or my grandmother, passed away when she was in her early 40s. And it was around 1918 when she passed away, I noticed. And I had always heard that it was maybe her heart or something that she died, but I realized that 1918 was a pandemic, flu epidemic, in that area, and a person in her early 40s could have passed away with influenza. And the other grandparents lived in Ripley. He worked for a foundry called Cleves Foundry in the Ripley area, right on Portage Lake. And he worked there for 50 years. So he must have started working at it in his late 20s because that's when he married my grandmother. And so he must have worked into his 70s, still working in the foundry in Ripley. Hekala and Hannus were my grandmother's maiden name was Hannus, H-A-N-N-U-S, and he was Hekala. And first lived in Pike River near Chassel, moved to Ripley for this job, and then stayed there present the rest of their lives. And my father grew up in Houghton Canal on the farm, and he met my mother, who was teaching school in Houghton Canal. And that's where they met, because it was on the neighboring farmer's 40. And they ended up getting married in 1931. At the time, my mother who was living in Ripley at the time, used to walk to on the weekend, walk home for the weekend, and in the winter she used to ski home, and she actually ski along Portage Lake and then cross when she got to the Houghton Canal area back and forth. So it was however, when she got married, she was at that time teaching in Ripley, and Ripley had a policy that a married woman could no longer teach school. Well, she fought that, and they did give in, and she was able to teach until she became pregnant with my oldest brother, and then she had to quit then. We were the first generation. We all came here. I think my grandfather on the Lottie side came with his brother in around 1890, and I think my grandfather on the Hekala side, on my mother's side, was a little bit later than that. And he came here to find work. It was pretty rough in Finland at that time, because it was a lot of immigrants that wanted to leave, and they heard that this was a pretty good place for a job. He came from a family in Tampere, and he was the oldest son. And apparently they had some property, you know, at the time, but he wanted to come to this country. And he came, was here about a year, a little over the year. He belonged to a Finnish temperance society, and they did a lot of acting. And he was all over the country acting in plays in the Finnish temperance association. So after a little more than a year, he went back to Finland, found out that the farm was given to his younger brother, and you know, and he said okay. So he was pretty good with that. He came back to the U.S. and settled here and went to work and met his spouse, my grandmother, and they had kids. He was really particularly interested in education for his kids. So actually I have an aunt who was a nurse, went to University of Michigan back in the 1920s. My mother was educated at Northern for teaching, and I had a uncle who went to SUMI at the time. Two of them went to SUMI, so it was pretty big on that side was education. We lived in West Hancock, which was about the end of where Hancock ended at the time. So it was kind of nice for a kid growing up because you had the whole West End all the way down to Portage Lake, which is a gradual incline, and you could sled there, or you could hike, or you could explore, walk down to the beach, and didn't really have to have paths. You didn't have to walk through somebody's yard as the rest of the town was. So it was kind of neat. I had a brother 10 years older, his name was William, and a brother Bruce, 8 years older. So I wasn't too close to my brothers because they were that much older, but we had a lot of kids in the neighborhood. I mean, every family had many kids and many dogs. So it was pretty good. Yeah, this is some of the things that I do that I would be very nervous of for my own kids and grandkids. But was going down Birch Street, which was a terribly high street, and you can't stop it. So I ended up having to tip it over going down the hill because you're crossing M203, and then after that you're in the water. So that was some of those things you do as a kid that, and even as a youngster, that you, as you get older like I am, well, you get a little worried. I had to shovel snow, and I had to fill the hopper. It was, everybody had either had a, you had to put your own coal in, directly in, but if you were fairly modern, you had a hopper, and you fill that at least once a day, sometimes twice, depending on how cold it was. And you'd go down the basement. I remember when I was about 7 or 8, I couldn't quite lift the whole shovel, so I'd have to tip it on the edge of the hopper and drop it into the coal. And also, because we were in West Hancock, that was a close proximity of our dump. And at that time, there was pretty many rats around the dump that wasn't controlled by any poisons or anything like that. So it wasn't a real good spot to be. But at certain times of the year, the rats would come back in toward town. And I remember one night I was down there with a little light above the hopper, and filling it, I looked up and I saw a rat looking at me from the rafters, and then jumped down on the hopper, and I just about dropped. So, well, then my father went down and trapped the rat, but that's the only time I remember one in the house, but that was enough to keep in my memory. I guess I never really thought of it much, but there were neighborhoods then. And East Hancock were the people that had a little more money, and they probably were mining officials. And it was pretty nice houses, quite big, and very classy looking. And then there was the center of town, and it was mostly businesses and some residential as well. And then West Hancock was a little more wide open and not so much of a supposedly moneyed group. But it wasn't a big factor for me growing up. I didn't say I'm not going to hang around with anybody from East Hancock or so on, because you all met them in school and they were different than the rest of everybody. So, but there might have been a little bit of that. There was, the neighbors, there's lots of Finnish people, but lots weren't either. We had a lot of my friends weren't. But since both my parents were, my grandparents all were, there was a lot of Finnish spoken. And my older brother, I guess, could speak it a little bit. My other brother, Bruce, didn't, and I didn't. But I do remember phrases in Finnish. And pronunciation is easy to remember too. But I used to always ask my grandfather to come and eat by saying Dulgan Surman. I still remember that. Well, they used to like to speak Finnish so we could understand them. So that was interesting. But they didn't discourage it, but they didn't encourage it for sure. And we didn't make a big effort to learn Finnish. And we certainly were proud of it. We didn't have any question about that. I first went to Sunday school with the Apostolic Church in Hancock for a year or two. And that was, it's funny how a lot of the congregations were referred to by the preacher's or the pastor's name. And that was called Michelson's Church. And there was a Heidemann's Church, which is another apostolic church in Hancock as well. But they named them after, I don't know which first or second or whatever, but I remember going there for a bit because my father was a member of that congregation. My mother was a member of the Finnish Evangelical Lutheran Church, which was in Hancock as well. Eventually ended up going there. And got confirmed there, and that church was in Hancock behind the Hotel Scott, and since moved to Gloria Day in West Hancock. But we used to go to church not every Sunday, but regularly, and Sunday school, of course. Yeah, I went to Ryan School as a youth and walked, and actually used to walk home for lunch as well. And so I think they must have given us a little more time for lunch. And the only time you could eat in school is if you had something going on. But the only kids that ate in school were bus kids. And my mother, for a while when I was when did you start teaching? Yeah, I was still in grade school. And she went back to teach to help educate my older brother. And at that time, I was able to bring my lunch and eat it in the lunchroom, or else go out for lunch myself. But it was good. It was about a 15-minute walk. And there was also patrol boys on the corners. And you might have mentioned that there weren't any patrol girls, I guess. It was all boys, yeah. And was kind of proud if you were a patrol boy, you had a badge, and that was a sixth grade, you could kind of be in charge. It was a little responsibility, and it was kind of nice. I liked it. School was good. I used to like current events. And something was called the Weekly Reader. I don't know if anybody else remembers that, but and it had some current events too in there, and I used to really like that. I used to like to read about politics. I used to like to read about history. So that you just learned on your own because you just liked it. So I did. I enjoyed that, and I did pretty good. Once I had later on in high school, they had a current events test. And I got 100%. I thought that was pretty good. It was not much, if I remember. I could have done better, I think. But you had to give, if class president as a senior, I had to give a speech. And I did that. I remember it was kind of funny. The day I had to give the speech, I had an abscess tooth, and it was puffed up on the side. So I was kind of, maybe nobody even noticed that, but I sure noticed it. They gave the speech, and I got through it. But it was mostly ceremonial, and you didn't have to do a whole lot of things, and it just happened, And I played basketball in high school. That was a sport I played track for a little bit. Maybe for a year. Basketball was really fun, and really enjoyed that. Met a lot of friends, and had a lot of fun playing it. There was also, as far as sports, we always played baseball, and played that through through school. And I was one of the few tennis players, and tennis court was nice court right near the football field, and played a lot of time with tennis. I still do that today. 2 and 3 times a week I play tennis, and it was, after many years of not playing tennis, and it's a nice. And growing up in Hancock was quite nice. I took French as a senior in high school, and it was first year French, and it was all girls in the class, and I sat next to Sharon Pardini, who ended up thinking that was a pretty good idea. So we got to meet there, and we got to be friends and dated. And got married a few years out of high school. I think Sharon was 2 years younger than me, or is 2 years younger than me. And she was out of high school about a year. And I was out for 3 years, and we got married. I was 20 and she was 19 at the time. And not Finnish, she wasn't Lutheran either, so she was Roman Catholic. And that was somewhat of an issue, just like I suppose it might be from Catholic marrying a Lutheran from that family, but not that big a deal. They really liked Sharon, so it wasn't it. And it was somewhat of an issue, but not much. The Catholic Church had a rule that when you married in the Catholic Church, even if you didn't have to be Catholic to marry a Catholic, but you had to sign up that you'd have to bring your kids up Catholic. Well, I had my fingers crossed, I think, on that one. By the way, let's see, Michelle was brought up, I forget, Lutheran or Catholic. I think Catholic. Lutheran. Probably knowing that once I started Lutheran, I was bossy about that. But then we switched. We went from each child. I never heard of anybody else doing as dumb a thing as this. But we did, and Mom went along with it. Till finally, the kids were rebelling, and they decided to go to the other church. So it ended up just falling apart. That was really foolish. But again, it was, pretty young, and you think you got all the answers, and you find out that you don't. So if I want to make a recommendation to anybody, is to be the same church if you can, and just give in and be one or the other, because it made it much more simple for the kids. I don't think it hurt anybody, but I don't think it helped either. But that was a move we made that is laughable now, but probably wasn't always. Well, that was just because everybody was off to doing things, and we wanted to make sure that we had a day that we could do something together. And usually it was a Sunday. Maybe it was a Saturday sometime, but principally a Sunday. And we'd all get together and go usually north, usually to the Keweenaw somewhere, or some kind of a family fun day. And obviously we needed to do, we had a good time. Oh, yeah, they were pretty good. But, after a short time, I think we stayed one time about 10 days, 11 days, and I told Sharon that I feel like getting a job. They were fun trips, especially when we had most of the kids. I don't know if we ever had the whole group in a car. But we ended up getting a van, which was easy transportation. But prior to that, we had a station wagon, and you couldn't walk around in a station wagon. You had to kind of sit or else lay in the back. So the little kids would be in the back. And I remember when I'm making the turn off of I-75 and go on Highway 4, I think it was, the beeline to Orlando, to Disney World. And that's after driving about 27 and a half hours from Hancock to Orlando straight. I was just plain tired, but you're so happy to get there. I remember leaning over the steering wheel and looking out the window. And this picture, this is a station wagon, a blue Pontiac station wagon with luggage on the roof. And I was leaning over there and I kind of looked outside and people went by and they were pointing their fingers at us and laughing because we looked, kids sticking out of windows and fogged up and it looked like dead tired. But they, obviously, you know, the moral of the story is if you can get away with your kids and do some vacationing and do that, you certainly remember those more than you do your work. Your work is fine. If you enjoy it, it's really good, but memorable things are, a lot of them are vacations, so I recommend them too. Well, I had intent to be a lawyer, so I took classes to that effect on pre-law, and I graduated from Northern, and I was already married. We had been married about 6 months when I graduated. And I went to Detroit to find a job because I was going to go to Detroit College of Law. I went there for the weekend at Christmas break, and I knew he was graduating in January, so I was able to get a job as an insurance adjuster, and then I then start going to law school. Well, while I was in law school, I didn't particularly like it. And I did like what I was doing as far as insurance and insurance adjuster. It was a good experience. And we ended up, I got another job from the adjusting job because I thought I could make a little bit more money. And I got into sales where I could see that if I sold more, I'd make more money. And you're kind of your own boss to get out there and do what you want. So that's what I really enjoyed too. But then I bumped into a lot of people when I was down there who was my age and a little bit older, who couldn't wait to retire and move back to the UP. So I thought, well, I'd like to do it before I get settled in. So came up here, moved to Hancock, contacted Northern Placement. Northern Placement told me about State Farm, might be interested, interviewed there, and got the job, opened up my own agency in town, and they've been doing it ever since. So it's kind of unusual to do that, stay there in one position for that long a time, but it's been a real good experience. It allows me to, because I was independent, allowed me to do other things as well. And I got involved in I've always thought about getting into real estate, even when I was at Northern. That sure made sense to me to work with something like that. And I got in little by little, and one thing led to another opportunity. And you could still do all those things and still be in your own town. You still could do something creative and still make some money out of it. So that's been very, very enjoyable. It was nice to do a few things like build a Ramada in Celeston and fix the old Hotel Scott, which was kind of sentimental because in high school I worked as a desk clerk at the Hotel Scott, and I used to run the elevator, because it had to be an elevator manually operated. So at that time I was just a senior and junior in high school. So it was a going concern at the time, and but at the time I ended up buying the Scott, it was in 2005 or 6, right about its 100th anniversary, and it was in terrible shape. There was a hardware store on the first floor, and then there were four floors above it, that were or five floors above the main floor, that were in terrible disrepair. The hallways were just like a roller coaster, dead pigeons all over the place, windows cracked and open. It was terrible. So it did take a big deal to bring it around. But now there are, with my wife Sharon's help on all these things, we were able to bring it around. And it's 28 apartments and three businesses downstairs. And it's very popular. And it turned out good. Ramada is still there. We since sold it. But real estate development was enjoyable for both Sharon and I. She particularly liked the design part of it and the decorating part of it. And plus, we always were a partnership. And before we do anything, rarely would we do anything without the others, you know, being agreeable. If Sharon didn't think that was a thing to do, normally I didn't do it. So it was a good partnership, and we enjoyed the work. So that was the job. And the job also with State Farm has been awesome. We allowed us to do all those things, and also get into politics as well, and that came later. I always said I'd never get into politics. I thought it'd be the last thing I want to do. I want to be in business, do what I've been doing, but certainly not get into politics. So mainly because my dad was a mayor of town and he was an alderman, and I heard all that all the time, and I knew he worked hard, and I don't want to do that. It just looked too much stress. But sure enough, there was an issue in school, and Sharon and I felt strongly about it. They wanted to kind of end Hancock schools and try a trial merger with Houghton at the time, and without being a consolidation vote. So I said, "Geez, Sharon, why don't you run for school board?" She said, "I'm not running for school board. You got to run for school board." So I did. And we did, and that's what got me on the school board, and enjoyed it. And then there was another issue that came along about 6 years later, when a developer bought the Houghton High School, and with the idea of tearing it down, and the county commission decided to pay to have it torn down and then build a jail in that space. And that was it. It wasn't up for a millage election, wasn't up for anything. And I heard that, I thought, this is crazy. I don't blame the developer for making a pretty good deal, have them pick up the tab for tearing it down and building the jail without any bid set up. But that got me involved in politics. I remember getting involved, there was this TV station in Calumet at the time. So I called them up and I said, I want to talk about this. And so I got on TV and said how I thought that was wrong to saddle the county with that debt of tearing down the school, and also to making a move on the jail when we hadn't decided that we needed a jail yet. So I ran for county commission and got in, and there was quite a few others that did as well, with the same feeling we did, and we just made sure that would be put up to a vote, not just get done, as far as the jail when it got shot down by a lot. So that what got me involved in politics with the county, and then went ahead to just being a state rep. That was very interesting, and all of these things. What's good about politics is if you're involved as much that you can get something done or make an impact on something or affect something, you get a lot of rewards from that, as well as meeting a lot of good people. So it was just a good time. I'm not involved now, and I'm just trying not to get involved. because and it's kind of free for that. But it was a fun time. Wouldn't trade it for anything. And got six kids, six children, four girls, two boys, and great kids, all hardworking, proud of them all.